We're broadcasting live. If you can tell us the topic of tonight and begin, that would be much appreciated.
Okay, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, our blessed Holy Trinity is one God. Amen. We are revisiting the Incarnation again, partly because we have not explored everything, partly because we very rarely treat the topic in depth. Last time, which was last week, and our memory must have been loaded with so many things that if you can remember what I have said, that will be a miracle. If you can't, you can't. But let me highlight some points and apply them to Christian life. Because through Christian theology, as actually Origen of Alexandria said, quoted by Evagrius, a theologian is someone who knows how to pray in a loud voice. And Saint Irenaeus, before Origen, said, we practice what we pray, and we pray what we practice. If this is so, let us visit some of the points and look at how we practice, how the Incarnation is deeply rooted in our practice. The first point, which I mentioned last time, was means and goal. Christ is the means and the goal. This is a rather simple way of saying he is the only mediator, the one who came in order not to amend and correct only, but to revive, to heal, to give life, and most important, to make this life immortal, which we call eternal life. This is the content of what we call in classical Orthodox theology, economia, plan of salvation. I shall try to use less Greek words in order not to distract your attention. That's why I used actually means and goal. Means because the problem of humanity was not sin. This has invaded our theological books from the Middle Ages and the Reformed tradition. The real dilemma and tragedy of our human life is thanatos, death, mortality. Forgiveness is easy, it's not a problem. Christ did not die to forgive us our sins only. That is a mutilation of the good news, which is the gospel. But he died on the cross in order to give us eternal life. But that's again half of the truth. He came to us and he united himself to our human body, took a human body and a human soul, like our body, like our soul, fully human and fully God. It is this union that made Christ the means and the goal. The incarnation will certainly help us to purify our minds and our understanding from applying or using any other means other than Jesus himself. The means to Jesus is Jesus himself. Why? Why should we insist on that? Number one, because no one can give life to the dead except the Logos Creator. No one can unite a creature to the Creator except the Creator himself. No one can give eternal life to those who were in the bondage of death except the one who has eternal life in himself. So when we seek Christ, we seek both the means and the goal. In fact, means and goal are used by us in practical life for daily affairs, but when it comes to the Lord himself, they are no longer two but one. It's a very comforting idea to think that if you need the Lord, it is the Lord who comes to your help. He is the one who can stretch his hand and bring you to the circle of life. And in this sense, the New Testament actually provided us with so many beautiful metaphors, like the good shepherd who seeks the lost sheep, like the husband who married a woman. Now he married the church in Ephesians chapter 5 and united himself to the church in order to purify the church and to bring the church to the glory of the life to come. Like the bread of life, which is not a metaphor, it is the gift of life. But the word bread, taken from our daily practice of the basic diet in Palestine in the days of Jesus, and he is the wine of God also, which is the blood of Christ, the nourishment, the feeding. And as we are born in the biological life, so also we are born into the new life by Christ and by the Spirit. This is the whole meaning of saying beginning and end also. The beginning is Christ, because we begin in him. And the end is Christ, because we end in that glorious status where we are the free children of God, free from corruption and from mortality. It's wonderful to see that all the mental tools of analysis that we use in our practical daily life, when they come to the incarnation, they stop. We can no longer use them. Like theory and practice. Theory and practice is a very good mental tool of looking at a topic. What is the theory? And then we look and see if that theory has any possibility of being applied to real life. There was a science in the old programs, but it's no longer there, called applied physics, applied science. It's not really good for a scientist to sit in the lab or in the library and to invent something that cannot be used. But Christ is not a theory and practice. And here we have acquired in our history, practically, millions of books that are no more than ideas. Ideas about Jesus. Did he exist? Did he call himself Lord? Was he conscious of his divinity? Was he made divine by Gentile Christians? Because the Jews could have accepted him as a prophet without a problem. And it's only the Gentile Christians that made him Lord and God. This was the theory that dominated theology in the 18th, 19th century. It's no longer viable. It has been defeated by Oscar Kuhlman and Joachim Ermias. Those who study theology would remember that there was an attempt in the German schools, especially by Friedrich Bauer and by others, to split Christology into high Christology and low Christology. Low Christology is Christ is a prophet and the teacher of the Torah. High Christology, Christ is the God divine. And people were always asking about whether you have high Christology or low Christology. Low Christology will be the Judeo communities that accepted the gospel, and high Christology will be the Gentile Christians that accepted the gospel. That was very disturbing, and it is false. I remember one of our best teachers in Cambridge, Charlie Moll, professor of New Testament. And in the dialogue between the church and the synagogue, where the Christians were kicked out of the synagogue at the Council of Yamna, which is a small village outside Gaza, around 95, maybe a little bit earlier, but under Gamaliel the Younger. And on the prayer for the Sabbath, the 18th benediction, they added a curse against the Christians, against the Nusroyo. And they called them the Bar Manim. The children of destruction. It's funny enough that this curse was denied by a Jewish historians, till the text was discovered in the synagogue of Ben Azra in Old Cairo, which is situated between St. Barbara and the Hanging Church in Old Cairo. I found the text and was published by Professor Doug Moore. It is very strange to see how the Christians could have been part of a worshiping community that meets on the Sabbath and believe in the resurrection of Jesus. It's what Charlie Moore used to say to us, that Christology actually started as high Christology, not as a low Christology. Because the divinity of Christ has been vindicated by his resurrection, and the more people spoke of the resurrection of Jesus, the more the people in the synagogue were offended. And that the title Savior, Soteros, is a title that belongs proper to God. So, here is the issue that when we talk about theory and practice, now, why high Christology is viable and true, and low Christology is false and actually leads us to death? Behind that, there is the culture, the Greco-Roman culture of the time. Man is mortal by nature. That's the Christian teaching. And Christ came to remove our mortality. And to do so, he cannot be a creature. He's divine. More important, our knowledge of God has been distorted. We need a divine revelation of God. So Christ came to reveal the Father to us. And he cannot reveal the Father unless he is the true Son of the Father. Unless he himself knows the Father fully and communicates with the Father. So my dear brothers and sisters, there is this high Christology that has battled with heresies. Low Christology will be welcomed by the Arians and by the historians and by the Gnostics and by anyone who does not see the predicament of humanity. When I was asked once to summarize the difference between Islam and Christianity, I said in one sentence, in Christianity, man is dead and he needs life eternal. In Islam, man is ignorant and he needs guidance and knowledge. That's why Sharia, the law, is a very vital part of Islam. But the gospel is the gospel of high Christology in the gospel of John. Let me insert something here that is very sad. John T. Robinson wrote a lovely book, has been printed here in America, reprinted, The Priority of the Gospel of John. Because most of the New Testament critics pushed the date of the Gospel of John to the year 90. For no reason. This is the work of Frederick Power, actually, in the Tübingen School. Comes John T. Robinson and pushed the date of the Gospel of John to the year 40, 45 maximum. to make it one of the earliest witnesses to Jesus. The old boys in the schools, especially in Britain, didn't like the book. Because they were students of the Germans, especially Bauer. And the book actually was printed after John Robinson died. We have to thank Professor Charlie Moll, who is responsible for the book. It's a great book to read. Let's look at this insight. In the Gospel of John, Christ says to the Jews, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. If at that time, the temple of Solomon, of the second temple, whatever you call it, the temple has been destroyed in the year 70 by the Romans. If at that time the temple was not in existence, that saying of Jesus in the Gospel of John could not have been written. It would have been actually meaningless. But because John is an early gospel, the problem, my dear brothers, in Christology and New Testament studies is about theory and practice. When you go to do a course in Christology, you get bombarded with ideas. Ideas about Jesus, here and there. It's fine. But then comes the crucial side of the gospel. How many of these ideas actually touch reality? And reality here is you and me, our condition. If Christ is a prophet, as Harnack used to say, and others in the school of critical textual criticism, then we have no problem. Then he is just a teacher of good manners. And there's nothing actually new. But as N.T. Wright noticed in a very shrewd way and said, the problem with the teaching of Jesus is that many things he said were easily accepted by the Jews, except one item, the kingdom of God. If you follow with me, you will receive the kingdom. You will be in the kingdom. I am here in order to give you access to the kingdom, to God's rule in your life. I give you the kingdom. For the Jews, that was certainly unacceptable. Who are you? And it is very sad that today, when we speak about the kingdom of God to many Christians, they say that the church today neglect the topic. It's not about repentance or love or forgiveness or any other topic that Christ could have been crucified. No. He was crucified for saying he gives the kingdom. And it is good to notice that in Tertullian and even in Gregory of Nyssa, the petition for the kingdom in the Lord's Prayer is not your kingdom come, but your spirit may come and dwell in us. Because the coming of the spirit is the coming of the kingdom. Yes, Tertullian and Gregory of Nyssa, indeed. We have that in one of the Madayih of the Great Lent in the Coptic Church. You can check that. So let's move on to means and goal, beginning and end, idea and practice. Now, if we exclude all these rather rattling ideas about means and goal, beginning, end, all these rattles, you know, beats like a drum, and look at the essence of the incarnation. What did incarnation actually bring into our practice? As I started early by saying how we live the incarnation. Saint Athanasius, in the last chapters on his book on the incarnation, wrote a statement many people thought it is rhetoric, an exaggeration. For he says that the blessing the incarnate Logos has bestowed on us is too many, and that he only highlighted some of them. Was he bluffing, or was he telling us the truth? He was telling us the truth. Because in practice, the incarnation brings a message to you and to me, that God loves our body, and that body made of flesh, tissues, bones, blood, is what God Himself put on in order to reveal Himself. And the revelation of God in the human body means simply that there is a revelation in actions that defines and gives meaning to the words. There is something tricky about Hebrew. When you use the word word, it is davar, rima. In Greek. But davar is not, or davar, depends which kind of Jew you are. Davar or davar is not just words, only action. It's also action. That's why in the Book of Wisdom of Solomon and the Proverbs say, this is the dabarim of King Solomon. Dabarim is the plural of davar, which means the teaching of wisdom. See, my mind never split idea and action. Only Western mind, because under Aristotle and Plato, we suffer from that split between mind and action. What are the actions that the incarnation actually gave to us? What are they? Can we name, say, three? That's to be humble. To be humble like Saint Athanasius, who says very little has been mentioned in his book. Number one is that the incarnation is a challenge to every theory, every idea, and it tells us whether the idea is correct or not. How is that? How is that? Tell you. When we talk about how God gets angry with sinners and punishes sinners, we are just saying how someone is beating up his own body. Because the incarnation made us the body of Christ. The church is the living body of Christ. And every believer is a member of that body. God is not a person who is mentally disturbed, who cuts off limbs of his body. When we sin, our guilt makes our sin lingers in our head. And we think that God is angry and upset with us. Not so. Oh, that God is very sad, neither angry nor sad. He is the Heavenly Father who is seeking our healing. So when I look at my body, I possess in myself the very realm in which God reveals himself. And I have been called by God in order to enter into deep communion with God because of the incarnate Son of God. The incarnation also changed our prayers. True Christian prayers are prayers which best takes their strength from the life, teaching, incarnation, death, resurrection, ascension of Jesus. Of course, I don't want to go into liturgical years. But of course, we think very often of the liturgical year, which is fine. But I don't want to go there. All I want to say to you that God help us, Christmas is coming. Christmas is coming, and in England say the geese are getting fat, you know. Prepare them for the Christmas banquet. We are the geese getting fed in order to be slaughtered by the consuming society. The incarnation is coming, and the incarnation is a union of the divine and the human. What has taken place in that union must take place in our life. Very hard, isn't it? Very hard because the pressure of morality and ethics and guilt. I am not worthy, I am little, I am nothing, I am small, I am been defiled, I have this, I have that, makes us belittle ourselves and look down at our being as human. But God united himself to our humanity in order that he may unite his divinity to our humanity. This is very clearly stated in the Psalmodia and in the Coptic liturgy. The last prayer before communion, known as confession. He united his divinity with his humanity, the separation, alteration, or confusion. He made his humanity and his divinity one life. Brothers and sisters, don't be bogged by Greek vocabulary. Physis, nature. Essence, ousia. or ousia, as the Greeks. The Greeks of Oxford, not the Greeks of Greece. Ousia. And people say, what is the difference between nature and substance? If you ask the Greeks, they will tell you, nature is what does exist. Essence is what is that in reality. That if you say you have a seat made of wood, and the table made of wood, and the door made of wood, these are three articles that actually possess the same nature, wood, reality. Substance is the essence of wood itself. What makes wood wood, according to Aristotle? So, of course, people ask me, if there is no real difference between essence or substance and nature, so when we participate in the divine nature, do we participate in the essence? This is a highly philosophical question. Gregory of Palamas answered the question in his according to his own tradition, and the answer is fine. It's great, actually. We need to look at it in depth, not tonight, but for the time being, it's enough to say that God maintains his mystery, and that is the substance of God, while his nature is revealed. The existence of God is his essence, but the activity and the revelation is the nature. Is there a difference? Of course not. Because we talk about the same person. Talk about the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, the three persons in one. What I want to say is that the incarnation is an action of union. Took place in Christ in order to give us the opportunity to be united with the Father by the Spirit and to become one with the Trinity. And this is the greatest news of the Gospel. To be one with the Father and the Holy Spirit in the Son doesn't allow me to explore the mystery of divine existence, which is essence, but allows me to have the glory of the Trinity through the union with Christ, through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, have a foretaste of the kingdom of incorruption, to have the divine life in me. Incarnation is always God adding human beings to that union. You and me and our children. Because incarnation is fulfilled in the church. When we think of the Virgin Mary, the Theotokos, as the door in heaven, the Ark of the Covenant, the tabernacle of the Old Covenant. All these are symbols of the divine presence. Now, the divine presence has superseded all these. It's no longer the burning bush, but humanity that has been sanctified. So all that glorious titles, images applied to the Virgin Mary is actually applied to the church, to you and me. Many people sever the relationship between Christ and the believers. The evangelicals are very unhappy with us. But that is certainly their fault. However, tonight we are not looking at the particular painful journey of the 16th century Reformation. The Incarnation also has handed over to us the divine actions of grace, which we call sacraments. Did you notice that in the three sacraments, baptism, chrismation, and Holy Communion, that they are actually part of the divine incarnate Son of God? Did you notice that in baptism we are baptized by being buried with him? And that in anointing we have been anointed because he was anointed by the Holy Spirit. And then in the Holy Communion we receive the body and the blood of Christ. So our liturgy, our life is centered on the actions, the divine actions that the Incarnation has brought to our life. We can spend all night talking, and I think you'll get tired. Well, if you don't get tired, I'll get tired because I'm an old man. But I like to conclude by saying that the great proclamation of the New Testament about the Incarnation is Christ being the second or the last Adam. This comes clearly in a big chunk in first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15, and in Romans chapter 5. You can see how the plan of God started with Adam, did not mature, moved to Christ, to its fulfillment, not leaving the new creation and its fate to the human will. I would love to repeat that statement again. Not revealing the new creation to the weakness of the human will, but re-establishing the new creation on the firm foundation of the union of the divine and the human. And that's why when we speak about grace in the New Testament, we speak of a change that took place in history and in time. Because in history and in time, God has united himself to a human flesh in order to give us a new flesh. So the cause of the resurrection is the incarnation. I hope I have succeeded and I have not made you weary. And by God's grace, we shall talk about the Council of Nicaea and the Council of Ephesus and the church struggle with the old questions, which we normally call Christology. May God the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit be with you forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Are there any questions out there? Okay, perhaps I can ask one to get the ball rolling. And so it's kind of one that I've had from last week. You brought up St. Gregory of Palamas this week and how he addressed the union and the mode of participation. But he also spoke about his own tradition. Now, something that some people find problematic is when he makes statement like, by means of the participation, we become unoriginate and uncreated. And this is precisely the point that many people have a problem. It's the type of language that people have a problem with, without understanding what it means to participate in the energies of God, which is what St. Gregory of Palamas continues to talk about. So if someone were to try and come to terms with that without knowing much of a background of the essence energies distinction, how can you explain that to people, precisely this type of language? How can you explain that to people who come from our tradition, if you will?
Well, by just saying that he means eternal life. Because the uncreated grace is a term I saw in the Coptic liturgical books. It's uncommon, but it is there. You see, created means came out of nothing. Mm-hmm. And is subjected to corruption and to death. Uncreated means it is given by God, is divine, and it is eternal. So the divinity and the eternity of the gift makes us participant in something that is not human, but divine. Not temporary, but eternal. Not from what the creation is, but what creation has received from the Divine Trinity. I think, you know, the triad of Gregory of Palamas, there is a new book by Greek theologian called Papadopoulos on the theology of Gregory. Mm-hmm. Great, actually very short, but very precise and very good. The section in John Meyendorf, Byzantine mm-hmm. theology, quite precise. Also in Vladimir Lossky also. Mm-hmm. But you see, when we speak such language, we speak about something that does not belong to the order of creation. No more. Something that is divine, mm-hmm. and that is no longer of this creation. Very hard for people who either under the influence of secular education or Muslims at heart to that knowing.
Yeah. Could it be said that the language itself is bold? Because he obviously he doesn't speak of the energies as being uncreated and unoriginate, but he extends that to man. He He says that man becomes unoriginate and uncreated, and people find that extremely bold language.
Yes, because I've become eternal.
Right.
I've become eternal, become like the maker.
So just while I have you on record, in saying that, we are not saying that man loses his humanity, but is rather transfigured into the divinity, so to speak, by means of the union. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes, but you know, Ramiz, we also have to be sure that in the center of our human awareness, see, this is a problem. I am not the origin of this.
Yeah.
It's not something that I, George, did manufacture.
Mm-hmm.
It's something that God gave to me.
Right.
You know, it's very hard to convince Copts today that they think they need 2-4 days after they commit sin in order to appease God. As if God like their mother-in-law or like their dad, you know?
Yeah.
You know, get upset and you know, really, and after a while, he will come to a kind of a mode of existence which makes him peaceful towards you.
Mm-hmm.
And if you tell him that is absolutely pagan understanding, God is very pleased with you, and he is assisting you to be restored because you hurt yourself and by sinning, and that don't apply this harsh self-condemnation to your life because it does not interest God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you.
It's a pleasure, sir.
So, doctor, if you know, the point is, if I'm given, if the Lord given me the union with Him, and I do not experience it, you know, what is the difference here? You know, if the Lord experience the gift of the Lord, absolutely. It's up to the Lord. It's not up to me. So if I'm not experiencing it, you know, I cannot express what I'm saying. Like when you said that what happened in the incarnation, what took place in the incarnation, has to take place in
you,
in me. So, but here it is, the revelation of the divinity of Christ didn't happen till the mount of temptation, after the mount of temptation, and nobody wants to go there.
Hmm.
I don't want to go there. So, is that has something to do with the experience of divinity?
No, we experience the divinity of Jesus in the sustenance, in the health, in the aid that we receive in time of distress, in the joy, in the peace that we receive in danger, in temptation. And down deep in our hearts, we know that Christ is divine, and He is lust and love. And sometimes if we are asked about an evidence, we can prove it. Because it's such an intimate relationship, and so intimate that it cannot be actually proved. That's another problem. The other side of the coin, as you say in English. So it is very important for us to notice the deep impact of the person of Jesus on my life. That I get away from him, but I cannot leave him. I deviate, but I come back to him. I am struggling, but he is sort of persuading me to come back to him. This is the work of the divine in the person of Jesus, which is part of the human struggle to know and to love God. That is the main point in our Christian life. I get away from him willingly sometimes at my will, and then I miss him, I come back to him, and he opens his arms wide open and receive me. You know, I turn my back to him, but after a while I miss him. There is always this constant thirst and hunger for him, because he has reshaped my being in order to rest in me. And he has a great desire to be resting inside me. We must teach our own people that message of hope, rather than teaching them how to be enslaved to guilt and to fear. Well, it's after 8 o'clock, and I think you had enough for tonight.
Never.
We love you, Doctor.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. George.
Yes, it's my pleasure. I'm waiting for you to come on the 12th. If you can bring Sameh with you, that would be a miracle.
Yeah, I wish. I wish.
The madame بتضحك يا سامح ولا ايه؟
Yeah, you know, مش يعني نفسها برضو انها تشوفك person to person.
يعني يا اخي صدقني اذا عندكم امكانيه تيجوا 12 مع سامح مع سوري مع رمز ومع الدكتور جو اهلا
وسهلا. الله يخليك يا دكتور، ربنا يخليك لينا يا رب.
عندنا مكان ونوكلكم احسن اكل موجود في امريكا، ما تخافوش. وعندنا بطاطين كفايه، وعندنا تدفئه في البيت، مش هتموت من البرد يعني.
ربنا يخليك لينا يا دكتور.
ايش يا حبيبي؟ سلامة محبة أخوة،
سلام.